In cholesterol synthesis, the goal is to make from multiple acetyl-CoA molecules that have only two carbons, one cholesterol molecule with 27 carbons. Acetyl-CoA molecules are formed by degradation of multiple glucose molecules. Recall that when glucose incomes into the cell, glucose undergoes glycolysis that results in production of pyruvate. And pyruvate, by pyruvate dehydrogenase, is converted into acetyl-CoA. And in a well-fed state, when tissue is fully saturated with energy, acetyl-CoA molecules are usually used in fatty acid synthesis or for production of cholesterol. So initially, two acetyl-CoA molecules condense together with formation of acetoacetyl-CoA. Now we have four carbons. Then condensation of acetoacetyl-CoA with acetyl-CoA results in formation of HMG-CoA that has six carbons. HMG-CoA undergo reduction that is provided by the major enzyme in cholesterol synthesis, HMG-CoA reductase. Very important that HMG-CoA reductase as cofactor use NADPH molecule. And this reaction results in production of mevalonic acid, so-called mevalonate. Then mevalonic acid undergo further condensation that results in formation of farnesyl pyrophosphate that has 15 carbons. Two farnesyl pyrophosphate molecules condense together with formation of squalene that has 30 carbons. Squalene then undergo conversion to lanosterol, and lanosterol, through multiple reactions that require NADPH, is converted to cholesterol with 27 carbons. Cholesterol can be used in multiple processes. Cholesterol can be used for synthesis of steroid hormones, for production of bile acids, for synthesis of vitamin D. Also, cholesterol is an essential component of the cellular membranes, and in addition to this, hepatocytes can pack cholesterol into very low-density lipoproteins, and in this form, cholesterol can be transported through the bloodstream. Now about the specific features of cholesterol synthesis that we have to know. First of all, we see that cholesterol synthesis requires a lot of NADPH molecules. Now recall that we have two sources of NADPH molecules. Most of the NADPH molecules come primarily from hexose monophosphate shunt. So hexose monophosphate shunt is the major source. And small amount of NADPH molecules are produced by malic enzyme. So malic enzyme is a minor source. Very high yield concept is that farnesyl pyrophosphate participates in synthesis of coenzyme Q. And as we know, coenzyme Q is an essential element of electron transport chain in mitochondria. And also farnesyl pyrophosphate is used for synthesis of dolichyl pyrophosphate that is used for N-link glycosylation of proteins. Now, in cholesterol synthesis, the major enzyme is HMG-CoA reductase. Naturally, this enzyme has hormonal regulation. HMG-CoA reductase is stimulated by insulin and inhibited by glucagon. And the way to remember that is that when we are looking at processes that require cholesterol, we see that cholesterol is used for anabolic processes. This word synthesis is everywhere. And the hormone that stimulates anabolic processes is insulin. On the other hand, glucagon is elevated in conditions like starvation. And in starvation, hepatocytes do not want to waste such massive amount of acetyl-CoA molecules for anabolic processes. In starvation, organism is trying to preserve energy. So glucagon inhibits HMG-CoA reductase. This subsequently causes accumulation of acetyl-CoA molecules, and liver tissue use acetyl-CoA for production of ketone bodies that will provide energy for peripheral tissues, as brain tissue for example. Also, cholesterol allosterically inhibits HMG-CoA reductase, so it's sort of typical reciprocal regulation. Now, to understand what is the major pathway of cholesterol utilization, we have to briefly discuss all of them. First of all, part of cholesterol molecules are used in synthesis of steroid hormones. And the major sites of steroid hormones production are adrenal glands, ovaries, and testes. Now, important to realize that the total amount of cholesterol in the body can be measured in milligrams. The amount of steroid hormones that are present in the body measured only in nanograms. So we can say that less than 1% of total cholesterol in the body used for synthesis of steroid hormones. Also, cholesterol is used in synthesis of bile acids that occurs in hepatocytes. The major enzyme in bile acid synthesis called 7-alpha-hydroxylase, and important that this enzyme has reciprocal regulation. 7-alpha-hydroxylase is inhibited by the bile acids. Now, why it's important? Recall that once hepatocytes produce bile acids income into the duodenum where they help to absorb fats. And after, 5% of the bile acids are excreted from the organism in the feces, and approximately 95% of them are reabsorbed in the ileum. And through the blood they come back to hepatocytes. And when they come back to hepatocytes, they inhibit 7-alpha-hydroxylase. And in response to this, hepatocytes produce only 5% of the bile acids to compensate these minimal losses. This entire process called enterohepatic circulation of the bile. So basically, because of enterohepatic circulation, hepatocytes have to produce only minimal amount of bile acids. Thereby, only minimal amount of cholesterol is used for bile acid production. Also, cholesterol is used for synthesis of vitamin D. Now, the level of vitamin D in the blood is approximately 30 nanograms. So, only minimal amount of cholesterol used for vitamin D production. Another option is that cholesterol is used as a structural component for formation of the cellular membranes in all cells through the body. Now, the major site of cholesterol production is liver tissue. So for hepatocytes, it's not a big deal to use cholesterol for membrane production. But for other cells, it's a problem because their cholesterol reserves are low. So cholesterol has to be delivered to them from the liver tissue. And the way how liver tissue delivers cholesterol to peripheral tissues is that in hepatocytes, cholesterol molecules, together with triacylglycerols, are packed into particles that are called very low density lipoproteins. And then hepatocytes secrete very low density lipoprotein particles into the blood, and through the bloodstream, these particles deliver cholesterol and triacylglycerols to the peripheral tissues. What we have to realize is that cholesterol is like a school notes about literature. At a certain point they are very helpful, but after we finish school, who cares about them? Total garbage. The same thing about the cholesterol. Cholesterol cannot be degraded to CO2 and water. Also, organism cannot produce ATP from cholesterol. So you better use cholesterol for a certain purpose, because otherwise cholesterol becomes a total garbage. And the problem is that cholesterol can accumulate on endothelial cells in the blood vessels, and progressive accumulation of cholesterol finally will cause atherosclerosis. The logic of atherosclerosis progression is that the higher the cholesterol synthesis, or the higher the cholesterol absorption, the more cholesterol molecules will be present in the bloodstream. The more rapidly cholesterol will be accumulating on endothelial cells, the more rapidly atherosclerosis develops. And we have a certain drugs that prevent atherosclerosis. This class of drugs called lipid-lowering drugs. The first one is niacin. And really important to know that niacin inhibits the production of very low-density lipoproteins. So, if the production of very low-density lipoproteins decrease, then the amount of cholesterol and triacylglycerols in the blood decrease. The lesser cholesterol molecules will be present in the bloodstream, the slower will be atherosclerosis progression. And also we have to know that niacin can cause flushing of the face. And actually, flushed face is a signature side effect of niacin. Another class of drugs called statins. Statins inhibit cholesterol synthesis. The concept is that statins, atorvastatin for example, decrease the activity of HMG-CoA reductase by competitive inhibition. Inhibition of HMG-CoA reductase causes decrease in cholesterol production. This leads to a decrease in cholesterol concentration in the bloodstream. Thereby, this causes decrease in cholesterol accumulation on endothelial cells, so the progression of atherosclerosis decreases. But the signature side effects of statins is hepatotoxicity that causes elevation of alanine aminotransferase and aspartate aminotransferase enzymes, and also myopathy. Now, the funny thing about the cholesterol is that because cholesterol cannot be degraded, The only way how we can get rid of cholesterol is by stimulation of cholesterol excretion from the body. And the only way how we can excrete cholesterol is by using of cholesterol for production of bile acids that can be excreted in the feces. The key enzyme in bile acid production is 7-alpha-hydroxylase that has this reciprocal inhibition by the bile acids. So to stimulate the activity of 7-alpha-hydroxylase, we have to decrease the amount of bile acids that come back to hepatocyte. And the solution here is a class of drugs called bile acid sequestrants, and one of them is cholesteramine. Cholesteramine is a positively charged substance, and bile acids, as acids, have negative charge. So positively charged cholesteramine binds to bile acids in the lumen of the small intestine, and in this complex, bile acids cannot be reabsorbed in the ileum. So this complex is excreted in the feces, and because the reabsorption of the bile acids decrease, the income to hepatocytes decrease. And this disinhibits 7-alpha-hydroxylase, thereby more cholesterol molecules can be used for production of new bile acids, so the less amount of cholesterol molecules remain in the organism. And the side effects of bile acid sequestrants is GI distress and decrease in absorption of fat-soluble drugs and fat-soluble vitamins. Now the concept is that hepatocytes cannot keep up with rapid tempo of bile acid excretion, and without bile acids, everything fat-soluble cannot be absorbed. So this results in decrease in absorption of fats, so more fats remain in the intestine and this will cause diarrhea. Also, absorption of fat-soluble drugs and fat-soluble vitamins will decrease.